بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق سيد المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم افتح علينا فتحا مبينا وارزقنا رزقا مباركا كريما. اللهم نور قلوبنا وعقولنا يا رب السماوات والأرض، وافتح علينا بفتحك المبين يا رب السماوات والأرض، وانشر علينا برحمتك. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent and the Merciful, and may the peace and blessings of Allah Azza wa Jal be upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Inshallah, we'll resume today with a discussion of one of the most glorious names of Allah Azza wa Jal, An-Nur, the light. We spent a good amount of time the last session addressing what Allah has meant by this name, An-Nur, to the extent that we can understand. Ultimately, each and every name of Allah is a name that He addresses the human being with. And this is extraordinary. It's an intimate message from Allah. So Allah introduces Himself to us. And He tells us that I want you to know me as someone who possesses this quality that you need. The names of Allah are a message of reaching out to you and me from Allah to tell us you need Allah. You need me. And the more that you know Allah Azza wa Jalla through His names, the more that you see how much you need Allah with that particular quality. And this name of Allah, dear brothers and sisters, An-Nur, addresses a fundamental need of the human being, just as the rest of the names of Allah. And it's the need for guidance, for light. And we spoke last time how we need physical light to see. The fact that something exists does not mean that you can see. We go through a simple example last time. You can exist in this room. You are now physically present in this room. But if you shut off the light, even though I have eyes, there is no physical light. I cannot see you. So I can assume that you're not even present here, which is incorrect. Now, in the spiritual realm, the same thing happens. A lot of people claim to know the truth. But just as I can claim that you're not here, even though you're here, it is true. You're here. But without physical light, I cannot see you. Allah tells us, without my spiritual light, you cannot see the truth. Even though you have the capacity to see, you cannot see without my light. Even if your mind has tricked you into believing that you can see. That's why people fight with each other saying, I know the truth. No, I know the truth. And they argue and they philosophize. But at the end of the day, who knows where the truth is? Only the one whose heart was illuminated by Allah. And if the truth becomes very evident, people who oppress brothers and sisters, people who kill, perhaps for them that heinous act at the moment where they've committed it, it might have seemed correct for them. What made them see falsehood as truth? The fact that the light was not reaching the heart. So it's a name that tells you, you need light. You need to see. And the only one who can supply this light is Allah. He's the light and the source of light that illuminates the heavens and the earth. Such a crucial thing that we recognize we need Allah's light for us to know how to think, how to behave, how to speak, how to feel, how to find, and how to search, to overcome doubt, to overcome uncertainty, to feel what is right. That feeling inside of your heart is not from you, it's from Allah. We've addressed this name, covered a few meanings, and we're putting all of this in the context of a glorious verse in the Qur'an that is considered to be among the most extraordinary verses. And all the Qur'an is amazing. But among the verses of Allah are ones that are even more special. And it's those verses that talk about Allah. So this is a verse that speaks about Allah, and it's the verse of Nur. It talks about light. Scholars have spent a lifetime studying this verse. And they have amassed volumes of knowledge about just this one verse in Surah An-Nur. Contains treasures, secrets from the heavens.
وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِّعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ.
Allah says there is not a blessing or a bounty or a gift that you have except that it's from Allah, including the gift of thanking Allah, including the gift of mentioning Allah's name. It's not your tongue that is mentioning. It's not your mind that is thinking. It's Allah bestowing His light on you to know Him and to remember Him. Allah has illuminated your mind and your heart to make the decision to come today. Say, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. So we're studying the name in the context of the verse. And there is no better way to study it than through the words of Allah. So let us listen to the words, inshaAllah, pay attention and reflect on it to see what else Allah wants us to know about His life. And ask Allah Azza wa Jalla for acceptance. And then inshaAllah, after the recitation, we'll continue the explanation.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. الله نور السماوات والأرض. مثل نوره كمشكات فيها مصباح. المصباح في زجاجة، الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية يكاد زيتها يضيء ولم تمسسه نار، نور على نور، نور على نور، يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس والله بكل شيء عليم. صدق الله العظيم.
So Allah says in this verse, Allah, just as Ayat al-Kursi, Allah begins the extraordinary verses with His word and His name. SubhanAllah, Allah. And there is no better introduction. I love it whenever Allah starts a verse by saying Allah. It's like sufficient.
أليس الله بكاف عبده.
There's a beautiful verse in which Allah says, isn't Allah sufficient for you? We search for meaning and purpose. We search for answers in our lives. We search for healing. We search for people to lift us. We search for something to give us hope. And we're never satisfied. Allah says, am I not sufficient for you? And within it is also a recognition that even His name is sufficient for you. His name by itself fills you. Fills your voice, fills your heart and your soul, but we're just not paying attention. That's all you need. Alhamdulillah for Allah has said. There is none that you need but Allah. So Allah says, Allah, I am here. I'm your Lord. No titles. Know me as Allah. I'm the one who cares for you. I'm the one whose eyes have never left you. Then he continues his introduction by saying,
نُورُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ.
He says, in this particular case, I want you to know me with one of my qualities and names. I am the light of the heavens and the earth. Earth and the heavens and what's in between them cannot function without my light. So it is that light that illuminates it and allows it to be what it is. It's the light that sustains it. It's a light that allows it to interconnect harmoniously in the manner that it is. It's a light of Allah that makes the creatures of Allah within the heavens and the earth find their way. It's the light that makes them know how to even feed themselves. It's the light of Allah. Only the light of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And He's telling you and me, you need this light. And you should ask me for it. Because you need it desperately in your life. And you're poor. And I'm the source of everything. La ilaha illallah.
Allahu nuru samawati wal ard.
And it's the light that can sustain you physically and spiritually. How can you capture and understand the light of Allah? It's hard. Allah could easily provide us the example of the sun and its rays as the best manifestation of His light. Because it's the most vivid. The purest and most powerful form of light in our existence is light of the sun. So why not say, look at the sun so that you can appreciate what Allah's light is about. But He didn't. There are other instances in the Quran where He's referring our minds and eyes to the sun to learn other lessons. But for us to understand His light, He wants us to look at another example, a parable. Parables of the Quran are among the best means of representing to our minds and hearts concepts and themes that might be difficult to understand. So parables are a means to facilitate understanding, simplify, because they're very symbolic. And we love pictures. If I present you a picture, it's stuck. You can see it all the time. And parables allow you to really see the fundamental meanings of life vividly, with a beautiful picture. So we see examples in the Quran where Allah describes life as a flower that grows, that blossoms, and then withers. He says, you see how beautiful it is, you fall in love with it, suddenly it disappears. Every time I look at a flower, I remember the meaning of life. So human beings will wither, your wealth will wither, your health will wither, everything will go away but Allah. It's a parable. This is another parable. So here's what he says in this method, in this parable. He says,
مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح.
He says, I want you to understand the example of my life. He says, the example of my life is like that mishka. Mishka has two meanings. It can either refer to a niche opening in the wall, and in the old Eastern houses, they used to place the lamps in a niche, and they place it high so that it can illuminate the home. So it's a niche in the wall, or it can refer to a lantern. Both meanings are valid. So he says, my light is like that niche. So he wants you to picture a niche, picture a lantern. He says,
كَمِشْكَاتٍ فِيهَا مِصْبَاحٍ. within this lantern or the niche, فيها مصباح, is a candle light. I want you to picture the candle within this lantern, sitting in the middle. Now, what does a candle do? Is it automatically lit? No, it has a wick. So it's a candle filling by itself with the capacity to shine, to burn. But it's not burning automatically.
المصباح في زجاجة.
So he says the lamp is sitting within glass. Every single one of those aspects of the verse has meaning. Allah's words are deliberate. Everything is placed accurately and with a specific meaning or meanings.
الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري.
He says the light or the glass that is enclosing the lamp is not normal glass. It's a glass that is shining light so brilliantly, so intensely, it's as if it's a brilliant star. That's how he tells you the glass looks.
الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة.
And this glass is lit from a blessed tree, زيتونة, olive tree.
زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية.
And this olive tree, he's even telling you about its location. It's neither to the east nor to the west. It's sitting in the middle. There's a reason why he says this.
يكاد زيتها يضيء ولم تمسسه نار.
As for the olive oil of the tree, glows so much with light, it's as if it's light itself, even though no fire has touched it. Then he says,
نور على نور يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء.
Light upon light. Allah guides his light whoever he wills.
ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس والله بكل شيء عليم.
And Allah indeed presents the parables, and Allah knows everything. End of the parable. The scholars have reflected on this and studied, and they tell us this is an address from Allah to the believer, and Allah's teaching us about Himself. And He tells us that if you really want to see the greatest manifestation of my light, don't look at the sun. I want you to look no further than the heart. Allah says, look at the niche or the lantern. It's as if it represents the chest cavity. Look at it. It's actually designed with a ribcage. Niche. Within the niche is lamp. Imagine, think of a candle. It has the wick on it, but it's not lit yet. What do you think this represents? Think about the heart. What is it that the heart has of the believer that makes it feel anything when Allah's name is mentioned? Or when it sees something of the creation of Allah? We're born with fitra. What is fitra? Innate nature. Allah has formulated you to have this nature within you that is like that candle. It's ready to know Allah. It has witnessed Allah already. It's ready to be lit. So it has the capacity. Just as somebody who is very intelligent and all they need is somebody to just teach them. And they're bright. They'll understand right away. They have the capacity. We have the innate capacity to find Allah and love Allah and believe in Him. So the lamb, the fitra, is ready to know Allah. All it needs is the light of Allah on it. It sees Him right away. It witnesses Him. Now this lamp is enclosed in glass. And the glass represents the heart. And the niche is the cavity, so to speak. So the heart is enclosing this lamp that has this nature, the fitra to know Allah has it, the lamp. So the lamp is flickering inside of your heart, built innately from Allah. Allah is inviting us to reflect on all of this. So He's telling you your heart is like glass. He's teaching us about our own nature. He's telling you, just as glass is very fragile, so is your heart. Allah gave us hearts, brothers and sisters, that feel quickly. They're very sensitive and delicate. And it's a feature of the healthy heart. So if a heart is not feeling something quickly, it's not feeling the pain, it means something has built up on it. It has lost its delicateness. And if glass has lost its delicateness, it's no longer glass. It's what makes glass glass. That's why we're protective of glass. You say, be careful, don't scratch it. So Allah's telling you, be careful, don't scratch that heart. It's very delicate and it's very responsive. It's a fragile vessel. What is the other feature? Transparent. So the fact that glass is transparent, what does that mean? It can reflect and receive. The transparency of the glass allows us to see what's inside of it, and there's nothing you can do to hide it. Even if you try. If there's iman in the heart, genuine, authentic iman, will you not see it? You have to see it. You have to see it even within yourself. It has to reflect out on your limbs. If it is iman, it has to come out. It's going to shine out through your behavior, through your speech, through your life. You cannot contain it, even if you try. If you have love in your heart, can you contain it? You cannot contain it. It's going to shine through. So if somebody like really loves you, without them saying a word, you'll know. It's going to shine through their behavior, through their gestures, through their energy. You're going to know that they have something for you in their heart because the heart is transparent. It's a blessing from Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's why the Prophet spoke about the heart so much. And he says that there is indeed within the body this morsel of flesh. If it's healthy, everything is healthy in you. And if it's sick, everything is sick in you. Because it affects everything. What is the cover of the glass of the heart? There's a number of things. Let us begin with sinning. Transgressing. Disobeying Allah Azza wa Jalla. The Prophet ﷺ says in a hadith, each time you sin, disobey Allah, a black dot is placed on this glass, on this heart. Well, what does this dot do? Cover a portion of it. But I can still see. So do the next one, another black dot, and another dot. So he says, you keep placing these black dots until a verse in the Quran gets fulfilled.
كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ
Allah says, indeed, whatever they have accumulated, earned, has built up a layer that covered their hearts. Ran. So you keep putting up this layer, dot, upon dot, until you have covered the whole thing. And if you cover the whole thing, nothing can come in. So no matter how much light you shine, you cannot see. I'm reminded here of the example of a car with a windshield. The car cannot come without wipers. Can you go in a straight line if there's something in front of you covering the glass, the windshield? Absolutely not. So what do you do right away? Do you wait for the dirt to build up? No, you wipe right away. As soon as dirt builds up, you turn on your wipers to clean the glass. But if you clean the glass, you don't even know that there wasn't a dot on it. You don't even know that it existed there. Once you wipe, wallahi, brothers and sisters, deep spiritual lessons from Allah. He says, your heart is so transparent. It has a natural capacity to reflect. Not only what's inside, but it also has a natural capacity to receive the light of Allah to light up the candle. So once the heart is lit by the Quran, automatically it has to fall in love with Allah. You put up a layer in between it, it cannot transmit the light. That's why people become arrogant with the Quran. Because if they're already egotistical, and ego is another layer, by the way. Ego is the false belief that you are it, I. The I destroys a human being. There is not a single thing that is good in us, except that it's from Allah. So the believer says, Allahu Akbar, Allah's greater, which means there's no room for ego. Once you say Allahu Akbar, it puts you into your place. And the ego is neutralized. The ego puts up a layer on your heart, it rejects. It says, I am the center. Allah wants to move you from a reality that is centered around you to a reality centered around Him. That's the absolute reality. So the ego, brothers and sisters, destroys the heart. Eliminates the transparency of the heart. The heart can no longer see. That's why people will open the Quran, hearing about the truth, and reject it. We have the capacity to clean or not clean. And how do we clean, brothers and sisters? We know the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. Istighfar. Seek forgiveness. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, there is not a time he was sitting down except that his friends used to say, we used to count and say, Astaghfirullah 70 times or 100 times. He's just sitting down saying, Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. I seek forgiveness, my Lord. I seek forgiveness. Look at the humility. Constantly conscious of Allah. Thinking, I might have said something right now that is not good. Let me make istighfar to Allah. Istighfar is a vehicle that allows you to gain forgiveness from Allah for things you know about and things you don't know about. And the things you don't know about are far greater. So you say astaghfirullah for everything. And Allah says, I'll bless you with it. I'll open my doors of provision for you. Provision, brothers and sisters, when you make istighfar. So he's asking this, you desperately need me. I want your heart to see me, clean it. The second is repentance, when you really repent to Allah. The third, doing the deeds. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, Allah provided us the healing. He says, follow the bad deed with a good deed right away. It eliminates it. Do you think it's only a matter of erasing it from your record? No, not just that. It's as if it never happened. For example, I wronged you. Right away I go apologize, sincerely. And I go help somebody out. These two good deeds will not only eliminate the bad deed from my record, especially if I sought forgiveness, but Allah through these good deeds will lift my soul, make me feel good. That's why they say, don't feel down when you mess up. Follow it immediately with a good deed. It will lift your soul up so that you have hope. Good deeds will let the light of Allah come into your soul and lift it up. It's not about making the error. It's about following the error with cleansing. It is also eliminating the dirt on the transparent glass of the heart. So next he says, the glass itself is lit from a tree. So remember, there's a lamp inside but it's not lit. But it has capacity. He says,
الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري.
He says, this glass, it's so bright in its inherent light. It has this glow to it as if it's light itself, even though it's not lit. He's saying, look at the glass. He says, it's shining with light intensely as if it's a brilliant star before any fire touches that glass. What is he telling you about your heart? Your heart is already ready to shine. It's like that brilliant star. Imagine if you actually shine another light on it, what's going to happen? SubhanAllah, that's what Allah says. If you were to recognize the gift within you and what it contains, wallahi, brothers and sisters, you recognize the love of Allah for you. Imagine now what happens when Allah lights or shines or illuminates that heart from the light. He says, this glass is going to be now lit. He says, from a blessed tree. And the tree is not a normal tree, it's an olive tree that is situated neither to the east nor to the west. The beauty of the glass that Allah presents as the example, as the object resembling the heart of the believer. He says, it's so beautiful. It's light, even though it's not light. SubhanAllah, you know, things that glow on their own, even though no light has touched them yet. What is he telling us about our hearts? They're so enormously good and beautiful. Each and every one of you. He's not just talking about a category of people. He says, I've given you hearts like this. So he says that this glass now, it has the natural capacity to emit. It glows, it's like a brilliant star, even though no light has touched it. But light is touching it. And what is that light?
يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية.
He says, well, it is lit. Because the light of Allah has to touch it. Allah is nur. Allah didn't create creation and cut himself off from the creation. So he says, it is lit from a blessed tree. Olive tree. He keeps adding features, like it says, blessed tree, then olive, zaytuna. Neither to the east nor to the west.
يَكَادُ زَيْتُهَا يُضِيءُ وَلَمْ تَمْسَسْهُ نَارٌ.
Now the olive oil of the tree, just as the glass was emitting light even though no light has touched it, it's like the brilliant star. The olive oil of the tree has the same feature. It is about to emit light even though no light has touched it. SubhanAllah, you have two things that are emitting light even though no light has touched them. The glass, the heart, and the olive oil of the tree. In broad terms, what do you think this tree could be? What does it represent? The symbolism. Anything that represents the guidance of Allah. Quran, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the revelation, knowledge which is contained in the Quran, the wisdom of the Quran, all the things that have reached us to Allah to illuminate the path are that tree. SubhanAllah. He says, as soon as that light of the tree comes and touches the glass, what happens?
SubhanAllah,
it's actually light upon light.
Nurun ala nur.
He's calling your heart nur, brothers. This is deep. It has the capacity for light, but he's calling it light. Now, it has the capacity in its own. Do you think, brothers and sisters, this Quran, these are the words of Allah. They're already a treasure. But are they operating in independence, in the cosmos? No, they're intended for us. So this does not work without your heart. It's intended for your heart. It's like the medicine. Well, the medicine, does it just sit on a shelf? The medicine is intended to heal. But it cannot heal until it is swallowed. So similarly this, it has all these incredible powers, but they need to touch. It is light, but the light will not benefit until it touches. So it comes onto your heart, it's nur, upon nur, and the result, both of them, produce this incredible light that shines. And because it's transparent, it's going to not only shine in, but now start shining out. This is the inevitable result of the light of Allah touching the heart. And because it is transparent, your heart will be touched by it and will melt. It'll be impacted right away. If there are no barriers, if there's no ego, no arrogance, no excessive sinning. When we excessively sin, what happens? Even when you hear the Quran, you're not feeling it. Something is not sitting right. Your salah, you're not feeling it. You know why? Because there's a layer. Why would he pick olive tree of all trees? Olives are among or have been the most expensive fruits in history. To the point where it was used by the Greeks as a currency. And it has tremendous health benefits. It is among all the oils considered to be the best oil. And the color of it is so beautiful. How many of us have just looked at olive oil and just paid attention and reflected on it? Remember what Allah said about it?
يَكَادُ زَيْتُهَا يُضِيءُ وَلَمْ تَمْسَسْهُ نَارُ.
Its oil is about to emit light even though no light has touched it. Have you looked at olive oil? If you actually look at olive oil, it's glowing. Allah's talking about it in the Quran. It's a feature from Allah and it's a reminder to you about the glow of the Quran. It is glowing even though nothing is touching it. Even before it touches your heart, it's glowing. It is considered also to be among the most consistent of oils in terms of its color and the consistency of the color. And in terms of its illuminating power, that's why it's been used to illuminate. It is the best of the illuminants for the coolness of the eye. What does that mean? If you use olive oil to light something, it's better for your eyes than other oils. SubhanAllah. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says it's zaytuna. It's a blessed olive tree. One of the features of it is that it's neither situated to the east nor to the west. This is fascinating. He says this tree, if it's sitting in the east, you know, when the sun comes out, it captures the light. But then the sun has to travel all the way. Well, we're traveling. It's not really the sun that is traveling. We're traveling around it. It's also traveling, but you catch my point. The tree is going to be far removed from the sun when it sets, so it's not going to receive the light when it travels across the sky. And if it's sitting in the west, it can only capture more light when the sun comes near, but not when it comes out. But what if it's sitting in the middle, in the center? It's receiving light all the time, light of Allah. And it's capable of delivering the light all the time. There's also a very deep message in this, about the placement of our deen, our way of life, our message. Our message is neither to the east nor to the west. It's on neither extreme. It's always been a middle path. It's always been a path of moderation. And only a path of moderation can address everybody. Why do you think Islam has been capable of reaching the far corners of this earth? Do you think it's because it came to cultures and tell them you have to change everything? No. It came and beautified and purified. But it never asked people to abandon their ways unless they clashed with the fundamentals of the faith. How? It maintained people, maintained their languages, maintained their arts, maintained whatever it is that they're doing, so long as it was within the realm of Islam, and purified them. But it allowed people to be. If it was situated to the east or west, not physically or geographically, in terms of its values, in terms of its relevance, it can only appeal to a certain type of people, and Islam would not have spread across earth. The power of this faith is that it is a center faith, capable of addressing the most genius and the simplest person. The people who are tough and the people who are soft. People of all walks of life, all cultures, all backgrounds. This is the power of this faith. And this is the beauty and the flexibility of our way of life. Be careful, brothers and sisters. Allah's faith is already balanced. Wherever we come and mess and tamper with it and act on behalf of Allah, we mess with the balance. Wallahi, we mess with the balance. It's already balanced and beautiful. And it is being referred to by this tree that is situated neither to the east nor to the west. Deep messages within it. And because it's at the center, it's constantly receiving the light. And it's constantly delivering fruits. And you notice a tree does not withhold its fruits. It doesn't say, I'm going to give it to you, but not you. The tree is sharing its blessings with everyone. It doesn't deprive. And so is the light of Allah. It comes on to everybody. The light of Allah is far-reaching. So if it has touched your heart, the heart cannot reflect anything but the goodness of Allah. And indeed, Allah says, once this light enters the heart, He says in the conclusion of this verse,
نُورٌ عَلَى نُورٌ.
Light upon light. And what do you expect when you have light upon? The heart already has the capacity for illumination, for luminosity. The light of the Quran comes upon it. You have this light upon light. What do you expect the outcome to be? Brilliance. Beauty. But what was the requirement? That this heart has to be for Allah. It cannot be covered by ego. It cannot be covered by arrogance. It cannot be covered by the self and the shadows of the self. It cannot be covered by layers and layers and layers of sinning and error. If it's covered by any of this, it cannot receive nor emit light. Now once you become a true servant of Allah, what does it mean to be a slave of Allah? I don't attribute anything to myself. Everything belongs to Allah. Any goodness. I'm not going to say I did anything. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. That's why we begin the Quran with Alhamdulillah. You're essentially attributing every good to Allah. But the more that you express this gratitude and you recognize your servitude to Allah, your placement. That's it. I'm a slave of Allah. What do you think Allah is going to do to your heart? He's going to make it like a mirror that reflects His goodness. By Allah it will shine. Now the more ego and arrogance you introduce, the more you're saying, I'm I.
the more that he deprived this heart of its reflective capacity.
Humble people, kind people, what do you say about them? Something about their goodness reminds me of Allah. You know what's happening? Because they're not about themselves, Allah allowed their hearts to be mirrors that reflect His kindness. What about people who have come to Allah through other attributes? Allah will make their hearts reflect those attributes. But if you say, I, me, it's all about your ego, Allah's going to say, good luck. There's no mirror. Your heart cannot receive light, nor can shine it. In conclusion, brothers and sisters, a few lessons, inshaAllah. And I think among them is the intimate message of Allah in this verse. He's talking about our hearts. Allah tells you have a beautiful, beloved heart. You cannot help it. That's been given to you automatically. Even before the iman came into it. It is so beloved to Allah. Even though you think that you are a messed up person, yes. Even though you think you have led a messed up life, yes. Even though you have done such and such sins, yes. When you see people leading mischievous lives, it's not because they have bad hearts, but they've corrupted their hearts. There's a big difference. We're blessed with good hearts, but we can corrupt the heart when we veil the heart. And it can no longer become a mirror that reflects the kindness and goodness of Allah. So that's number one. Allah saying, your heart is so beautiful, I'm going to make it a vessel for my light. Do you think Allah will place His light in any vessel? Would you place your jewelry in any box? No? You'll pull it in a clean box, good box. You can lock it. The more precious the possession that you have, you will be keen to put it in a safe, good place. So you think Allah will place His light in any random place? Absolutely not. But He'll choose your heart to put His light. So the best representation of His light becomes your heart. Allah saying, realize what you have. And realize your capacity. Brothers and sisters, you have incredible capacity. Most of us live lives without realizing the potential. Because we've been numbed by this life. We're pursuing the wrong things. So we end up not fulfilling the Allah-given capacity that He's placed within our hearts and souls. What is it that illuminates the heart? Begin with the Quran, brothers and sisters. Allah called it Noor. If you're struggling in your heart and your heart is tired, this is the Noor, the light of Allah, the vehicle that delivers the package of light to that vessel of yours called the heart. And the more that you connect with this, the more that you allow light to come into your heart to eliminate or wash away this layer of darkness, and the more that it allows it to come closer to Allah Azza wa Jal and shine that light. Quran, knowledge. How can you fight ignorance? Your own unawareness. Knowledge, brothers and sisters. Learning. How much do we make an effort to remove the veil of ignorance in our hearts? How many of us are just stuck on the same knowledge that we've learned 40 years ago or 50 years ago? It is knowledge that illuminates the heart. That's why the first verse of the Quran was Iqra. Read and learn and grow. Conquer this world with your understanding and the power of learning. In whatever and all fields of knowledge are the fields of knowledge of Allah. It's called learn. And Allah has given you the capacity to learn something. We've talked about cleansing the heart. There's two more points, inshaAllah. Allah has expectations. He's saying, I've already given you an instrument so powerful. It's ready to receive. It has luminosity in it. It's already light. Light shines upon it and it's light upon light. The function of light is to be emitted and spread. So the light of Allah shines without restriction. It's not confined. Now, if it comes into the heart, first of all, it's going to empower you with your iman, with your mission on earth, bringing closer to Allah, making you worship more, making you do good deeds. It's going to make you feel iman. That's the light of Allah. But what is the natural outcome? It's light, and your heart is transparent. If the light of Allah has entered your heart, it has to shine. So if something is not shining, that means there's something wrong. So what is Allah's expectation of us here? What are you doing with my light? It's the trust. When it entered the heart of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, what did you do with it? It empowered him. It's like the fire underneath him. So the light of Allah is energy that empowers you to move. And iman, once it enters the heart, it cannot be contained. It has to shine through on your limbs and now in the way you live your life. It's going to have to come out on your face, in your speech. But Allah is asking you, have you taken this light to those who cannot see the light? Because it's a gift of Allah. The ultimate tragedy is for us not to appreciate the light of Allah, and that once we're touched by it, not to shine it on to others around us. But light, brothers and sisters, also means hope, means empowerment, means helping people get up and see, not beating them up. Remember how light functions. It is not forceful. It is flexible. It's beautiful. It flows. And yet it allows people to see without them knowing that it came from this source. And if Allah has allowed you to shine your light on whoever is around you, in whatever means Allah has given you, perhaps in the way you treat your parents, in lifting up the soul of a human being who's broken in your family or among your friends, on your neighbors, whatever it is, Allah has given you capacity to shine his light. Are we doing it or not? This is the mission of every believer on earth. Shine the light of Allah on creation and become a lamb. Are we like lambs, or are we among people who make people's paths dark, extinguish their hope? This is one of the deepest lessons of this verse, to become a shining medium of the light of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And in conclusion, I say the following. We have to recognize our desperate need for light. That's why the first surah of the Quran begins with, praise be to Allah. Why would Allah place in Surah Al-Fatiha, guide us to the straight path, ihdina surat al-mustaqim. He's teaching us that the most significant request, prayer, supplication you can make of me is to ask me for guidance. And what is guidance but light of Allah Azza wa Jalla? So he's teaching us in that surah, ask for my light to shine upon you. For if Allah bless you to see Allah in your life, to live in the presence of Allah, that Allah is the center of your life. If Allah has given your heart the ability to see this, say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. That's the ultimate gift. And that's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to always make the dua, Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqa, wa Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan wa arzuqna ittiba'ah. Oh Allah, make us see with your light truth as truth. And make us also through your light see how to follow that truth. And make us see falsehood as falsehood, and make us avoid it. He was so keen to ask for the light of Allah. Oh Allah, grant us your light. Because he recognized that a blind heart that doesn't see the light of Allah is no good. And it's the heart that is failing. And it's going to lead you to a life that is failing. And this whole verse was about making you recognize the need for Allah's light, and to look within your heart and recognize the beauty that Allah Azza wa Jal has placed within it. And with that, inshallah, we conclude this verse. May Allah enlighten all of our hearts with His love. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to guide our hearts and make them see the truth as truth, and make us follow it. We ask Allah, O Allah, make us see falsehood as falsehood. Make us avoid it. O Allah, illuminate our hearts and souls with your remembrance. O Allah, make our hearts receptacles and vessels to receive your light and shine your light upon creation around us, Ya Allah. O Allah, do not deprive us of your light. O Allah, do not deprive us of your light. O Allah, do not deprive us of your light. Make us lamps that shine your light across this earth, Ya Allah. O Allah, make us among those who are guided to the straight path, the path of those who are the recipients of your favors and blessings on this earth, not the path of those who have received your path, nor those who have gone astray. اللهم امين اللهم امين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته